The world is on fire. Scientists warn the flames are fanned by climate change, and world leaders know urgent action is needed.
The infernos and hurricanes we have seen over the last few weeks are only a very small window into what our future could look like.
Yet for all their official concern and ambitious new programs, there's one global warming factor politicians have refused to tackle.
I don't think they even discuss it.
It's quite bonkers. It's not been looked at properly before.
Most European Union governments, along with those all over the world, are deliberately ignoring one of their most prolific polluters. They've completely excluded it from commitments to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. So who's getting out of this fight against climate change? The military.
EU politicians have been very busy making dramatic plans to save the planet, setting a lofty goal for net greenhouse gas emissions of zero. When it comes to cutting carbon and the like, zero is the magic number.
And it's not just magic, it's mandatory. EU governments are legally required to come up with ways to take as much of the harmful gases out of the air as they put in it. And they have to get to this net zero by 2050. Sounds great, right? The problem is the numbers don't add up.
Governments carefully calculate emissions from many sectors, like energy, transport, and industry. That's crucial information when working out what can be reduced or offset with that goal of net zero. But you can't do that math correctly without counting the military, in many cases, a country's largest single source of greenhouse gas emissions.
I'm not sure that all militaries realize that, that they are.
That they're the biggest emitters, or that they're keeping it secret?
The biggest single emitter.
So big that at least one military emits more greenhouse gases than some entire countries. A project at Brown University estimated that in 2017, the American Armed Forces alone created more emissions than, for example, all of Portugal or Sweden.
The study says if the U.S. military were a country, it would rank somewhere between the 47th and 55th biggest polluter in the world. But nobody knows for sure because governments don't have to reveal their military emissions.
And most choose to share zero.
The military sector turned out to be like a hole where nobody knew anything.
That's what EU lawmaker Malin Björk learned when she wanted to find out how big the military's carbon footprint might be. She's a disarmament advocate.
The reporting is just not there. So the military is excluded from obligations of reporting. According to both the Kyoto Protocol, the Paris Agreement, the military doesn't have to report. And that has consequences. They don't. And in several countries, there were no national figures on the military emission.
No national figures on EU military's emissions, even though governments do collect and publish figures for other sectors and expect them to reduce those emissions, but not the armed forces.
Apparently here, no accountability, no target setting, no participation in facing our generations or our, time's most pressing issue.
The 1997 Kyoto Protocol was the first international attempt to limit global emissions. But when it came to the military share, governments argued that publishing figures could reveal critical information about their arsenals and activities, so they were allowed to keep that information secret.
Kyoto's successor, the Paris Agreement of 2015, doesn't specifically exempt the defense sector, but it leaves it up to governments to decide how and where to cut their emissions.
And still, no mandatory reporting. Finding only patchy and partial figures, Björk and fellow EU lawmakers from the left group commissioned their own study from environmental NGOs.
You always follow the money to see where the largest emissions are going to be. So, and why hasn't this been done before? Why are we the first people as a relatively small NGO based in the UK to look at EU emissions of the military? It's quite bonkers. It's not been looked at properly before.
Lindsay Cottrell works for the Conflict and Environment Observatory. She was one of the researchers on the study and says leaving out the military is no small omission of emissions.
You're talking about a huge sector. You're talking about a sector that has a global expenditure last year of $2 trillion US dollars. And that's increased despite the pandemic. They're typically the largest government agency emissions because of their fuel expenditure, etc.
The study she worked on looked at the six EU countries with the largest defense budgets: France, Germany, Italy, the Netherlands, Poland, and Spain. Only some of them choose to voluntarily report some of their military emissions.
Our estimates, based on the data that we did have available, which was sparse and there are quite a few gaps in that, from that we estimated that the annual EU military emissions are around about 24 million tonnes per year. That was for 2019. And when you look at what was actually reported to the UN, that was around 4.5 million tonnes. So there's a big discrepancy between what's been reported and what we've estimated.
Are governments just lying?
It's just lack of it's complete lack of transparency.
Well, that's lying, isn't it?
Well, you could say that, but the military have no obligation in many countries to provide this reporting. So if they're not being asked to provide it, then they've got no requirement.
So planes like this are flying under the radar when it comes to carbon emissions, thanks to that exemption based on national security concerns. No country seems to be publishing the full extent of their military emissions, and so far there's little public pressure to make them.
But we've learned it's not only that EU governments won't tell what their military emissions are, they don't even know because they don't measure. We asked one Estonian EU lawmaker if his country calculates military emissions.
No, and I don't think any other country does.
Riho Terras used to be Estonia's chief of defense, so he would know. He suggests fighting climate change could put European militaries at a disadvantage.
I don't think it is possible, because then we should be sure that the adversary will do the same thing. I mean, and that would not happen for sure not. Russia, nor China would consider that as a priority. But if countries could do it sensibly, having the military readiness on the high level, then it makes sense.
But the European Union's latest emissions reduction plan doesn't require measuring, much less reporting military emissions. Now remember, EU governments are legally bound to become carbon neutral by the year 2050. If they're not adding in their military output, how do they even know how much they have to cut to get to net zero? So if the EU isn't on it, who might be able to convince armed forces to count and curb their military emissions? How about NATO?
Global warming is a crisis multiplier, and it will affect our security, and therefore it matters for NATO.
NATO Secretary General Jens Stoltenberg has some serious green credentials. He's a former UN climate envoy. He was at those Kyoto negotiations when the militaries got their free pass on emissions. But he says time's up.
Military has not been part of the climate effort. And that was possible when we didn't have so big ambitions when it comes to total reductions. When more and more allies want net zero, then we have to include military in one way or another. What at least we need is better data, better figures for military emissions. And thirdly, of course, we cannot end up in a situation where we have to choose between either green and environmentally friendly military or effective. We need to reconcile the need for operational effectiveness and reduced emissions.
Others take it even further and argue militaries will lose effectiveness if they don't reduce emissions.
Operational readiness is related to our security environment, and climate change changes that security environment, so it also affects the operational capabilities that we have, down to the soldier level. If he needs to operate in 50, 60 degrees Celsius, we need to change his equipment so that he's able to do that.
General Tom Middendorp used to command the Dutch Armed Forces and admits being late to link global warming and defense. Now he chairs an international council of experts on the military and climate change.
Climate change is a direct threat to our harbors, to our key facilities. Sea level rise, in the biggest naval base in the world is in Norfolk in the U.S. The Navy already has to sail out several times per year because the water is coming too high and it will only increase. So we need to protect those kind of facilities and make sure that even in this changing climate, we are still ready to do our job.
At their June summit in Brussels, NATO leaders adopted an action plan to increase analysis, assessment, and awareness of the threats posed by climate change. But on emissions, the only commitment was that NATO will come up with a system to finally measure them in a consistent way. That, says the plan, eventually could contribute to formulating voluntary goals to reduce greenhouse gas emissions from the military. A basic but necessary step on NATO's part, experts say.
Up until now, obviously, climate change has been an enormous security headache, which allies have been dealing with individually, but surprisingly, NATO wasn't.
It was Jamie Shea's own headache for years as he headed NATO's Office of Emerging Security Challenges. He urges allies to support the action plan.
This is all the more important, paradoxically, Terry, at a time when, obviously, more confrontation with Russia, more geopolitical competition is meaning that military forces are trained. They're exercising more frequently, you know, they're getting their tanks and their armored personnel carriers, their fighters out of the warehouses, and they're flying them around to demonstrate resolve. NATO has to demonstrate deterrence, but it also means that the Allies are burning up a lot more fuel for these exercises. And if Allied governments are committed to climate change, I don't think they can give their security alliance a free pass.
The environmentally minded Stoltenberg only has one more year in this job, and there's significant doubt he'll manage to get NATO militaries to start cutting emissions. Estonia's former defense chief Riho Terras is among those skeptical allies will take much action within NATO, but he thinks they may eventually end up changing for other reasons.
I'm not sure that they have agreed on reducing the emission of the militaries, and I don't think they even discuss it. But since members of NATO are members of the EU mostly, and in EU the Green Deal is in the big business, so probably the countries will do it.
There's no reason or no excuse for an individual government to not do their piece of work. So, and that would maybe be the message. So don't wait for somebody else to do it. You just start to do it. I don't see why France is not reporting. I don't see why, you know, Spain is not reporting properly. Just do it.
In the end, that's what it's going to come down to. Individual governments deciding on their own to reduce one of their biggest sources of greenhouse gases. NATO will come up with a way to count military emissions, but has no power to make governments report what they find or reduce it. The EU could have made military emissions an issue in its Green Deal goal to become climate neutral by 2050, but it didn't. So where are we heading?
Some countries are stepping up. The American military, NATO's largest, has pledged to reduce its greenhouse gas emissions after President Joe Biden declared the climate crisis central to U.S. foreign and security policy. The U.K. has produced an aggressive climate action plan for its military, acknowledging that defense produces half the U.K. government's total emissions. And that same UK government is in charge of the next big thing in environment policy, the UN Climate Summit in Glasgow in November. But the topic of curbing military emissions is not even mentioned on the presidency agenda. EU lawmaker Bjork still believes the world is slowly waking up to the climate crisis.
I do think even the fact that climate has now been put on the highest level of priority for so many people, and especially the young ones, shows that something has changed. There is a shift going on. People are ready to see things that maybe 10 years ago people did not want to see.
The pressure is growing, and the generation of voters who will live through climate change is coming of age. They aren't likely to give militaries or anyone else a free pass.